On December 31, 1983, Brigadier Sani Abacha, then commander of the 9th Mechanised Infantry Brigade based at Ikeja, arrived to deliver the speech that ended the administration of President Shehu Shagari and Nigeria's second experiment with democracy. Major-General Muhammadu Buhari, former General of SAR commanding of the 3rd Armoured Division, emerged as the head of state, while Brigadier Tunde Diagbon, a former military secretary, was appointed Chief of Staff, Supreme Headquarters, and Brigadier Ibrahim Babangida, former Director of Army Staff Duties and Plans, and the operational backbone of the coup, assumed the position of Chief of Army Staff. Declaring itself an offshoot of the Muritala Obasanjo government of the late 70s, the Buhari regime pushed the uppermost echelon of the armed forces, retiring all officers of the rank equivalent to Major General or above as of the time of the coup. But that was not all. Buhari detained most political leaders of the Second Republic, accusing them of indiscipline and profligacy. For the first time in Nigerian history, the country's security organizations were actively used to track down alleged acts of corruption through the Special Investigation Bureau preparatory to formal military-style trials at Boni Camp. As had been the initial practice by various prior military regimes, special asset recovery military tribunals were set up all over the country. A War Against Indiscipline WAI program was launched. Such indiscipline was interpreted broadly to mean lack of environmental cleanliness, lack of manners such as failing to take one's place in queues, corruption, smuggling, desecration of the flag, and disloyalty to the anthem. The State Security Detention of Persons Decree No. 2 of 1984 gave the Chief of Staff, Supreme Headquarters, Major General Tunde Idiagbon, the power to detain anyone labeled a security risk for up to 6 months without trial. Decree No. 4 of 1984 was promulgated to prevent journalists from reporting news that could potentially embarrass government officials. Nduka Irabor and Tunde Thompson were convicted under the decree. Some high-visibility special interest groups, including the National Association of Nigerian Students, NANS, and Nigerian Medical Association, NMA, ran afoul of the government and were outlawed. The Labour Congress was also banned from undertaking strike action. In July 1984, in what was clearly a high-risk move, the Buhari government, allegedly assisted by Israeli intelligence, unsuccessfully attempted to kidnap Umaru Diko, the self-exiled Second Republic Transportation Minister, from a flat in London. He was grabbed while taking a stroll, bundled into a van, placed into a crate, and taken to the Stansted Airport outside London. Just before embarkation on a Lagos-bound cargo plane, suspicious British police and customs officers, already alerted by Diko's assistants who witnessed the kidnap from a window, aborted the heist. The incident created a diplomatic storm and even resulted in tit-for-tat seizures of Nigerian and British Airways aircraft in London and Lagos. High commissioners to both countries were withdrawn and were not reinstated until February 1986. To address economic issues, Buhari introduced austerity measures. He closed the country's borders, which were not reopened until March 1, 1986, and expelled illegal aliens. Severe limitations were placed on imports. Smuggling and foreign exchange offenses were viewed as acts of economic sabotage, with severe penalties. Unfortunately, accompanied by high inflation, these measures made business onerous for import-dependent local businesses. Many workers were retrenched in the public and private sectors at a time prices of elementary food items, caused in part by famine, were rising. Nevertheless, with all the attributes of a military operation, the color design of Nigeria's currency was also changed in April 1984, in part to deal with fake notes in local and regional circulation thought to be affecting liquidity, but also to undercut corruptly expropriated cash stocks outside the country. To deal with the emerging problem of narcotics trafficking, a retrospective law was passed to have suspects arrested, tried, convicted, and shot. Separately, the Buhari government or agents purportedly acting on its behalf emulated several important personalities and opinion leaders in the country. It remains controversial to this day whether some of these activities were undertaken, not by the Supreme Headquarters per se, but by lower echelons in the army, specifically the Directorate of Military Intelligence, as part of a PSYOPs campaign to discredit the regime and set it up for the kill. At 6 a.m. on Tuesday, August 27, 1985, a Muslim public holiday, unsuspecting Nigerians woke up to the familiar cycles of martial music interspersed with a radio announcement made in an unfamiliar voice. It was Colonel Joshua Nimyel Dogonyaro, the director of the Department of Armour at the Army headquarters. Among other things he said, and I quote, "A small group of individuals in the Supreme Military Council had abused their power and failed to listen to the advice of their colleagues or the public about tackling the country's economic problems." End of quote. Dogonyaro then announced that the regime of Major-General Muhammadu Buhari had been deposed. Hours later, at about 1 p.m., the more familiar voice of Brigadier Sani Abacha, then GOC, 2nd Mechanised Division of the Nigerian Army, based in Ibadan, came to announce the appointment of Major-General Ibrahim Badamasi Babangida, then Chief of Army Staff, as the new Head of State and Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces. Babangida, having flown back to the capital from Minna in his home state, where he was allegedly on vacation, subsequently took the title of President. The position of Chief of Staff, Supreme Headquarters, was eliminated. Navy Commodore Ebitu Ukiwe, then Flag Officer Commanding Western Naval Command, was appointed to the new position of Chief of General Staff, CGS, at the General Staff Headquarters. So, what was the reason for the coup? All coups are usually justified in highbrow terms designed to appeal to the emotions and patriotism of the uninformed public. This was no different. Each of the three speeches made that day by Dogonyaro, Abacha, and finally Babangida himself went to great lengths to rationalize the palace coup and make expedient gestures designed to appeal to cheap populist instincts. The official line was that the erstwhile head of state and his deputy, Major General Tunde Ideagbon, were guilty of dictatorial lack of consultation with their military colleagues, gross abuse of human rights exemplified by mass detention of politicians and others without due process, proscription of professional organizations, muzzling of the press, and promulgation of retroactive laws, for example, execution of drug peddlers. To this was added insensitivity to respected leaders of thought in various parts of Nigeria, the issue of counter-trade and alleged intent to take the IMF loan against popular wishes. The real problem, however, was a profound personality clash and divergence of expectations and priorities among the officers and civilians who originally conspired to effect or benefit from the removal of President Shagari in 1983. Over the years, more mundane reasons for the August coup have become public knowledge. For example, in an unpublished 1989 thesis by then-Major Abibu Idris Shuaibu, the reason for the coup against Buhari was that Buhari did not distribute positions to junior officers. Regarding civilian involvement, other unconfirmed reports speculate profound displeasure on the part of Chief MKO Abiola, who was alleged to have helped finance the 1983 coup. Abiola was upset not only with the decision of the Buhari regime to seize and auction a large consignment of his newsprint, which had allegedly been smuggled into the country, but also with an inquiry into the possible role of a relative in the drug trade. This, the story alleges, motivated Abiola to financially assist Buhari's removal. Another reason for the coup is that tensions between the army, specifically Babangida and Abacha, and the Buhari regime, specifically Buhari and Ideagbon, came to a head when the Ministry of Defense contracts and accounts were placed under scrutiny. Babangida was then reportedly placed under intense surveillance, including wiretaps by the Nigerian Security Organization NSO, prompting him to pressure the coup planners to stop prevaricating, act quickly, or leave him no choice but to escape. Buhari was removed in the nick of time before his government could formally officially gazette the retirement, which was revoked by executive order immediately after Babangida came to power. enjoyed the video, don't hesitate to like and share it with your friends. You can subscribe to our channel and turn on the notification bell to receive new videos as they drop. Also, don't miss our other video on how Johnson Aguiyi Ironsi was overthrown as Nigeria's head of state in 1966.